Hey there, welcome back to PD Medications, Purposes, and Mechanisms. I'm going to be talking to you today about dopamine agonists. We're on the home stretch because we only have one more episode before we conclude this series where we talk about levodopa and carbidopa-levodopa. So we're kind of working our way down to the main two medications that you see for Parkinson's disease. Dopamine agonists are probably one of the most common medications prescribed either by themselves or alongside of carbidopa-levodopa. Let's roll the intro. I'll see you on the other side. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. Okay, so without going too much into detail on the mechanism of levodopa, think about it this way. If you take levodopa, you're taking essentially what the body will convert into dopamine so that you can use it for all the purposes that dopamine has for use in the brain and the body. Now, there are receptor cells all over the place that accept dopamine as a neurotransmitter and then on the other side convert that into an action. Anything that's an agonist is going to activate a receptor. Anything that's an antagonist is going to block that receptor. We alluded to that previously with the adenosine A2A antagonist medications that we discussed. But dopamine agonists will bond with dopamine receptors and essentially mimic or act just like dopamine when they bond with those receptors. So dopamine agonists, in short, are a way to increase the effect of dopamine without having to take a medication that has to chemically convert into dopamine once it passes through into the brain. Essentially, this is also a way to boost the effect of what you're already taking if you're taking levodopa or carbidopa-levodopa. Over time, it takes higher and higher doses of dopamine to have the same effect due to a buildup of tolerance. So dopamine agonists can be a great way to add to this effect of effectiveness of dopamine without having to increase levodopa. Let's go into the most common brand names and generics for dopamine agonists that you will see prescribed. First is pramipexole and pramipexole extended release, or Mirapex. And then there's ropinirole or Requip. There's also a Requip XL, which is another version that's extended release. Next, there's apomorphine hydrochloride injection, or Apokin, and then apomorphine hydrochloride, or Kinmobi. And the Kinmobi is a sublingual film that dissolves under the tongue. And last, there's rotigotine transdermal, or the Nupro patch. So with all those medications we just named, they either come in a capsule or tablet, or they have different mechanisms of getting into the body, such as across the skin, which the transdermal patch, you have the injection, or the sublingual, which is absorbed right into the bloodstream under the tongue. So there's multiple methods of getting these medications in the body. Interestingly enough, you tend to see these dopamine agonists prescribed for conditions like restless leg syndrome and akathisias. In a previous video that I recorded, it's been almost a couple of years now, I talked about restless leg syndrome. I'll link that up here. But Requip and Mirapex are common medications prescribed for conditions like RLS. There's some question about whether RLS and Parkinson's disease may or may not be interrelated. That's kind of up in the air. All right, so let's go into side effects. Now, I have to say, first off the bat, one of the most important side effects to be aware of when you start taking this medication are compulsive behaviors. These are the things that can really ruin relationships if not taken care of early on or if you're not aware of it. So compulsive behaviors that I'm talking about would include things like compulsive shopping, gambling, eating addictions, and even sexual addictions. I've read and heard about stories where the spouse of a person with Parkinson's disease was being driven crazy by their spouse who just wanted to make love, have intercourse all the time, just to the point of ridiculousness. But also, people may even seek out sexual satisfaction from other people outside their marriage if it's a strong enough desire. So obviously infidelity can happen without medications helping it, but in this case, it may truly not be the person's completely under their control that they're seeking this out. Those tend to be pretty common side effects, even though it's not extremely common, but just really be aware of that. Also, common side effects that are included, but maybe not so quite so problematic, are problems like excessive daytime sleepiness or sleep attacks. I say that's not problematic, but it really is if you're trying to drive and do things out in the community. So if you are having excessive daytime sleepiness or sleep attacks, please don't be behind the wheel. I just have to say that now. But next, along with other medications we've talked about, you have confusion, possibly hallucinations. It can lower your blood pressure or cause lightheadedness. You can also have leg discoloration and swelling. And finally, dyskinesias, again, because your dopamine levels are a little bit higher taking these medications, you can have increased involuntary movements because of the dosage. So again, as a quick recap, you tend to see dopamine agonists prescribed either as a standalone therapy or alongside levodopa as a way to keep those dopamine levels elevated and improve motor symptoms in particular. As usual, I'll make sure to put a link in the description or the show notes so that you can access the page on Parkinson's Foundation where this can be read if you prefer to look at it visually in addition to hearing it from me on this video. We got one more video to go. I look forward to bringing it to you where we talk about levodopa and carbidopa levodopa. And that will conclude our series. Looking forward to that. Looking forward to discussing this with you further. And as always, be empowered. I'll catch you next time.